Richard Garriott.
Richard Garriott.
Richard Garriott.
Richard, thanks for coming on.
Acclaimed video game designer, Richard Garriott.
Deep in the heart of Texas lies the home of Richard Garriott, a video game mogul whose house is a real-life version of the fantasy-filled medieval times featured in his games.
Hey, come right on in. Ultima Online was really the first major commercial success in online gaming. I've taken those earnings and I've taken myself on voyages and expeditions across the globe, places like the Titanic and hydrothermal vents. I've gone to Antarctica a few times hunting meteorites and things of this nature.
The latest space tourist, American Richard Garriott, blasted off from the Baikonur Space Base in Kazakhstan on October 12th.
So this is actually really fresh in my mind, and it's something that I'm frankly quite eager to share because it was such an amazing trip for me personally that this kind of helped me let it live on a little bit, so to speak.
Go back to when you were 12 years old and your father was up in Skylab. Tell me about that. Did that inspire you to want to go into space?
Growing up, of course, my father was an astronaut, all my neighbors were astronauts, and if they weren't an astronaut, they were a NASA engineer or scientist involved in taking people to space. And so I grew up believing everybody was going to go to space because everybody knew did go to space.
Richard Garriott, a video game developer from Texas, has paid $35 million US dollars for the opportunity to go into space.
On October 12th, I will launch and become the first second generation American astronaut. From a young age, I actually devoted a lot of my personal investing towards the privatization of space travel.
This is the goal that I have really been working towards for 20 to 30 years.
When I was a teenager and my eyesight started going bad, the NASA doctor told me, hey, Richard, I hate to be the one to break it to you, but your poor eyesight's going to prevent you from ever being selected as a NASA astronaut. And for me, that was like being told, you're no longer eligible for the club that everyone you know is a member of.
So far, only the Russians have launched tourists into space. But others are planning to and involved, including Garriott himself.
Google co-founder Sergey Brin has placed a $5 million deposit on a future space flight.
But when I go on these trips, I don't just go to take pictures and leave nothing but footprints. I actually go and I find what gives me enjoyment and purpose in going on these really unusual expeditions is we usually go and look for scientific samples of one kind or another, bring it back, hand it over to universities, try to develop commercial products, things of this nature. Pretty much this entire year, I've been in Star City, just outside of Moscow, training. I think the demand for private access to space is going to continue to grow and grow. I also happen to be an investor in Space Adventures, a company that's making this happen, and we're hopeful that in the long run, the cost of getting private citizens to space will come down dramatically. So if I can't go with NASA, I'm going to have to go build a private industry to take people into space so I can go. And it really was that simple. And to say. On October 12th, I launched on a Russian Soyuz rocket that looks like this model here, up to the International Space Station, becoming the first second-generation American astronaut. And I flew in space with the first second-generation Russian cosmonaut.
And liftoff.
Liftoff of the Soyuz rocket transporting Mike Fink, Yuri Lonchakov, and Richard Garriott to their home in space.
And so it was only once I had passed all my individual exams that I was then approved to train with my crew for the things that we would be doing together. But I have to tell you, it is not a good part of your day when you decide it's time to go to class to go to the spinning chair. Because the goal is you sit in the chair and spin and tip your head from side to side until you get sick. And you stop before you throw up, but you still stop and you still got a headache and you still feel somewhat nauseous. And for the rest of the day, you actually feel bad. And in Baikonur, I did it every single day. And so it truly was not much fun. And then as a crew, we actually had to pass a set of final exams with a giant board of observers and press. Then there's sea survival training. For sea survival, they make you change out of your spacesuit and into open water survival gear before you pop the hatch and get out in case the thing is sinking. And so you have a limited amount of time to do that in, but the time limit is really because while the hatch is closed, it's getting hotter and hotter and hotter on the inside. And so that night we studied and studied and studied to figure out how to all the exact maneuvers necessary to pull it off in time. It takes you a while to develop your what I'll call flying, your Superman skills. And so as a beginner, you tend to push off one wall, bang against the other wall, push, bang against the other wall, push, bang against the other wall. Every surface is used for something. And so, because there's no real clear floor, there's no clear area of anything. The ceiling's got gear packed all over it, the walls have gear packed all over it, which you might call the floor has gear packed all over it. and any cables that are running from place to place, you know, since there's no gravity to hold things down, things just tend to run around through the empty space around you, so you're constantly having to move things out of the way to kind of swim through them as you go through. Just like with all my other trips, I feel this kind of moral obligation to, you know, and frankly, it also just makes it more fun for me, if I have what I'll call a deeper purpose to the whole trip. And so I did a whole bunch of what I think of as fundamental research and commercial activity. I did a bunch of educational outreach with schools around the globe. I volunteered for a bunch of medical work for NASA and ESA.
Probably the most complex experiment that I will be performing involves protein crystal growth.
It turns out for every biological function that exists, there is a unique protein. But one of the best ways to image a protein is to take those proteins with you into space where there's no convection currents, and then grow a crystal of that protein in space over a very long period of time. Then you can bring that crystal to the ground, rush it to a lab, use X-ray diffraction, and you get a very accurate structure, which is extremely valuable to medical research. My dad, 25 years ago, took the first ham radio into space, the first amateur radio, which I, on the 25th anniversary, I did the same thing he did, so the ham radio community was very excited about it. Plus, it's the way I communicated with schools all around the globe was to use the ham radio that's on board. And we did this thing called Operation Immortality, where we took, my latest game, Tabula Rasa, describes how the Earth is going to be invaded by aliens and overrun. And so we thought, well, if in case it's overrun, if I take a time capsule with me and leave it on board the space station, and that way any of the DNA that we take up there would survive the devastation of the Earth. So it was really funny. You know, first we started with local dignitaries, but then the word spread, you know, more and more famous people decided they wanted to participate.
And who is going to be my DNA astro mule, gazillionaire video game designer and space tourist, Richard Garriott? Richard! More importantly, Richard, if the aliens create an alien-human hybrid, I want to be the top half, okay?
Of course.
Richard Garriott, everybody. We'll be right back.
So we got one of my favorite guys, Stephen Colbert, you know, of the Colbert Report. So, you know, I've got my wrist strong bracelet, and I took one to space and actually sent one on a spacewalk. And we took up Stephen Hawking's DNA, and Stephen Hawking's a person now that I could call a friend. I've been to his house a few times and flown zero-G parabolas with him, and I took his DNA to space. You know that bad eyesight that I had when I was a kid? It turns out now, because of that, I've had laser eye surgery corrected some years ago, but I'm therefore the first person who has ever flown in space who's had corrective eye surgery. And so NASA was very interested specifically in studying that. So it's really funny, the thing that kept me from being an astronaut is now the thing that NASA was most interested in. You know, and if you're talking about whether you guys are gonna get to space, you will, within your lifetimes, easily be able to take a trip to space for about the same price as a round-the-world first-class trip ticket, so I believe that will occur.